Quantum computing in the NISQ era. Noisy intermediate scale quantum, or NISQ. What does this mean exactly? Well, the term was first coined in 2018 by John Preskill, and it references to the current state of quantum hardware. So we're working with about, at maximum, 50 to 100 qubits on devices. And example devices would include trapped ion devices and superconducting devices. These devices have been able to demonstrate some useful things, but they're far from demonstrating their full potential. The term NISQ also references the fact that qubits are currently noisy because they're highly susceptible to error. Limitations in current hardware include size and constraints of the devices, so the hardware itself, errors that exist and can come into the computation, coherence times of the qubits, and that's just to name a few. NISQ specifically refers to quantum technology that does not include error correction techniques. In the long term, we're hoping to move towards fault-tolerant quantum computing methods. Let's discuss how logical and physical qubits are different. So a logical qubit is a perfect qubit that is used within a circuit diagram or algorithm, whereas a physical qubit is a qubit that is physically implemented in hardware. Examples of those include ions, superconducting circuits, photons, among others. So here we have a logical circuit, or we have logical qubits within a circuit, and we have to map these qubits to physical qubits. So in the NISQ era, we have a one-to-one mapping with logical qubits to physical qubits. In the future, that'll change. Physical qubits today have a lot of noise that cause computation errors. Many complex algorithms need near-perfect qubits, and that's not going to be obtainable with current hardware if we don't have error correction. With quantum error correction, we'll need approximately 1,000 plus qubits working together so that they can correct mistakes that might happen during computation. And all of these physical qubits, so 1,000 plus physical qubits, will make just one logical qubit. To give perspective, here we have 50 physical qubits, so multiply that by 20 plus to create one single logical qubit. So quantum computers must get a lot larger and a little bit more robust in order to implement quantum error correction. We might not see these types of devices for the next 10 plus years. Some example sources of error in quantum systems include decoherence. So we have limited compute time before our state becomes unstable and too noisy to discern any sort of meaningful results. For superconducting systems today, states stay coherent for tens of microseconds. Types of decoherence include T1 error, which is amplitude dampening. So we go from an excited state to a ground state, for example, and then T2 error, which is dephasing. So we lose that phase aspect that's so important to quantum computing. We also encounter calibration error, and this involves our physical operations varying from the ideal operation. So while we're trying to establish the physical processes that implement like gate, for example, our calibration processes or our tuning processes were slightly off. So the physical implementation doesn't exactly model what we should see in an ideal case. We also have crosstalk. And that is where qubits feel their surroundings and are impacted. So that could include two qubit operations becoming less or having a reduced fidelity because they both executed at the same time, or a qubit feeling the operations happening on qubits around them. Additionally, we have gate fidelity. So gate execution that fails essentially with a certain percentage, and that's determined during calibration. For superconductors, we have a gate failure rate for two qubit gates about 1 to 2%, and for single qubit gates of around 0.1%. There's also measurement fidelity. So in this, we have to see how accurately our measurement operations reflect the actual state of our qubits. Finally, we have state initialization. And in this, we have to make sure that our qubits start in an initial state that we know before we process them. And with state initialization error, we have qubits starting up in an unknown starting state. So what are the impacts of error? Error might seem small, especially with those metrics we just described, but over time it accumulates, and that has a very, very negative effect on our processing. So for example, if circuits have too many gates or have high error measurements, the results are too inaccurate to actually be useful. In this example circuit, we can see the differences between a simulation and a real quantum machine run. So here we have one NOT gate followed by a swap gate and three measurements. In the simulation, we have a 100% chance of observing the probability, or we have a 100% chance of observing the correct outcome, a 1-0-1 state, which we expect because we have a ket 0 turning into a ket 1, swapping that with the information between the first and second qubit, resulting in an expected measurement of 0-1-0. That's reflected in the simulation. On a quantum machine run, however, we have a 6.543% reduced probability of success. And that's because of all the different sources of error that we encounter when running on a real machine. So as a note, this is a very small circuit and we still had a reduced performance of about a 6.5%. So we can see how that can get to grow pretty significant, how that can grow pretty significantly as our circuits increase in size. Let's look at an example of the limits of hardware. Would we expect this following circuit to run? So let's say we have a device that has a single qubit gate time of 4 × 10⁻⁸ seconds, a 2-qubit gate time of 5 × 10⁻⁷ seconds, and a coherence time for the device of 5 × 10⁻⁶ seconds, or 5 microseconds. So we have the following circuit, and we want to determine if we can actually run it on our proposed device. So what we'll do is count up all of the elements in our circuit, so our single qubit gates and our 2-qubit gates. So we have 5 single qubit gates, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 2-qubit gates, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and we multiply our counts by the time for each gate. That equals 5.2 × 10⁻⁶ seconds. Unfortunately, that exceeds the bounds of our coherence time. So we don't expect that the circuit will run with high fidelity on our proposed real machine. Important design considerations for quantum computers include connectivity. Connectivity is important because if we have limited connections between qubits, we'll need to insert extra qubit operations in order to form swap networks to implement algorithms. As we just saw with our timing example, this could significantly increase the time of our circuit execution. It also will increase the amount of error with the extra gates. We also need to consider the gate set that we use because some gates are going to be more complex and they must be decomposed into simpler ones. And some basis sets are going to be easier to implement as compared to others. For example, the IBM gate library includes control NOT, the identity operation, Z rotations, square root of NOT operations, and NOT operations. Software is also important whenever we are working with quantum machines. We want to have compilers and tools that make the best use of the hardware and available resources. And as another example, we're going to look into the process involved with mapping an algorithm into an executable. And with this, we're going to see that what we plan for an algorithm is not always what we get, even though it is logically equivalent. So here is our original circuit. It includes a Toffoli gate. Unfortunately, the Toffoli gate is too complex to implement on hardware. So first, we would decompose that Toffoli into single and 2-qubit operations. But this decomposition uses gates that are not supported by the gate library. Here we're targeting the IBM backend. Once we decompose once again into the gate library and we take into consideration mapping, so in particular, we're mapping to a device called IBM QROM, we have to see that we have to decompose into the supported physical operations and also insert swap operations so that we can communicate across the qubits to implement the algorithm. Some takeaways. NISQ era devices have demonstrated their potential, but we are far from reaching the maximum potential of quantum computing. Current hardware in the NISQ era is severely limited by errors associated with algorithm execution, such as gate error, measurement error, et cetera, and design challenges associated with building the devices themselves. Much research and engineering is needed to scale into larger devices, and eventually these larger devices will be able to implement fault-tolerant quantum computing methods.